What's going on, you guys? Hope you're having a great week so far. So, as some of you requested, I actually published some 2D puzzle games at the Play Store. So, some of you are wondering how exactly I built a game like this, as you see here. So basically it's a 2D puzzle board, right? And then the swipe UI is quite similar to Bejeweled. So if this, you know, if you want to learn how to make this line of life code, then I'd watch the whole video. But if this is like what you want as your end product for your project, I provided in the link in the description. So as you'll see there, the GitHub repository is there. Okay, so I was able to build this with exclusively Android Studio. So I didn't use any of the gaming SDKs like libgdx or Unity. But instead, it's like my way of hacking, where I used a view group consisting of child views, and then I manipulated them so I could actually make something like this, as you'll see later on. But so what I want you to notice is some functionality in this project. So I don't know if you noticed, but here, let me start this app over. Okay, so right when I open this, so we got here a 3x3 board, which consists of 9 tiles. And it initially starts off as scrambled, right? You know, that's what you'd want in any kind of game. So we're gonna learn how to do that functionality. And then another functionality, as you'll notice here, is the size, you know, the size of the board, where it occupies most of the screen. And then believe it or not, this happens in most, if not all, screen devices. Okay, so we're gonna learn that as well. And then what I've been doing for like the past, like ever since the video started. So as you'll see here, the tiles swap, you know, it's kind of like Bejeweled. Okay, so we'll learn that as well. And then if we actually try to solve this puzzle, or jigsaw puzzle that is, let's see what happens. So put it there, as you'll see, a toast pops up saying you win. So we'll include a method for that. Okay, alright, so without further ado, let's open up a new project. Close that. Oh, by the way, excuse my obnoxious laptop fan. Even though I'm still not used to this to this day. Okay, let's name this sample. Next. Finish. Okay, let that load up. So that's done, out of the way. Okay, let's close this so get some memory in for once. Alright, let's get started. So, as you'll notice here, took a screenshot of the board and solved. So, let's get the basics down first. So, as you'll notice, it's 3x3. Okay, so 3 columns. Alright, so set up some constants. That name of columns, which is 3, and then the constants dimensions, which is columns, right? Okay, looking back at this board, right? So, in order to get like some of the functionality, like the scramble or like the tile swapping, we're actually going to need to iterate through this board. Okay, so let's create a string array of all the tiles. Alright. Okay, so then let's create an instantiating method. And then let's actually let's build the tallest up. Alright. And then considering that the string array is filled with empty values, we should actually give it some, you know. Okay, that. So we got that. Alright. So as you'll notice here, with this I incrementing variable, we're assigning each value in the string area of 9 values. So obviously it'd be in order, right? Which is not what we want. As I mentioned earlier, we want the board to start off scrambled. So let's create here a scramble method. Okay, and in order to make a functionality like, you know, like this, I'm gonna initialize some temporary variables. Okay, so that. And we are gonna use the random class to help us with just that. Alright, so we got that taken care of. Now, what we wanna do, iterate through each of the values inside the tallest. Oh, actually, hold on now. Let's do tallest.length minus 1. So let's iterate backwards. Okay, so that. And then let's initialize this index value. Random.nextInt. Hold on. So it's actually been a while since I've like looked at this code, so give me some time here. Okay, let's try this. Plus 1. Okay, so that's that. With this, the temporary variable, I'm gonna assign it with the index. Alright, so what we're actually going to do with this method is we're going to do similar, like, you know, looking back at this board, so you know how I swiped, right, the swap UI, so it's kind of like that, okay, so when it starts off with this board, each of the tiles will be swapped with, you know, some other tile in the index, so it's technically the same thing, so here let's that. Okay, so we're gonna swap those and oops, sorry. Alright. So what we have here is we'll be iterating through each of the tiles, right, in the string array. And then we're gonna, you know, reference this temporary index variable, and then we're gonna index it and then initialize it here to the temporary string variable, right? And then the swap UI will be mostly done through here. Okay, so these will be stored in memory. Okay, so this will be there, and then the swap will all happen through these three lines. Okay. So, alright, so we got that out of the way. Okay, so alright, now let's display it. So let's create display method. Alright, so the objective is to display each of the tiles, which correlates with the each of the string variable. So we're gonna have 9 tiles of them. So actually, I have a directory here. So these will be the tiles of each of the pigeons. Okay, so let's copy those. Put it in here. Okay, so the objective here is to, so remember how I mentioned earlier that this board, you know, is a view group or a grid view, okay? So this grid view will have buttons in which will like set backgrounds to, which will give each of the images. So it won't be your ordinary buttons like what you see here on the paint, like this, but it'll be like buttons with actual images to get the board. So in order to do that, let's create an array list of buttons. Okay. Initialize that. So you're probably wondering why I didn't make a field for this. It's because we're actually going to use this display method multiple times. Not just, you know, when the app first opens, but each time we make a swap. So we're going to have to keep reinitializing this array list of buttons. It'll become more clear later on, but just to get that out of the way. Alright, so let's initialize the button. Okay, so now let's iterate through each of the tile list values. Okay, and then let's actually instantiate to the buttons. Okay, so that's that. Alright. So what's next is, if you guys know how indexing works, so you know how it's 9 tiles here? So it'd be from 0, 1, 2, all the way down to 8. Okay, so for the index 0, we have a tile here. Okay, so that'll be the first pigeon piece of that, right? So let's do just that. Tile list equals. Remember, these are strings, right? Okay, so. And then. Retrieve that button. Set background as this one. Create a stat one. R.drawable. Oop, can't spell. Put your piece one right. So, that's that. And then. See you guys later after I finish this. Alright, that's done. Okay, so now don't forget we have this array. So, what we should do now is for each button that's set with the background of the, you know, respective pigeon piece, let's actually add it. Okay, that. Add the button. Okay, so next, what I would say is to render each of these buttons to, you know, the grid view. So in order to do that, we need to build a custom adapter. But what I'd say first is actually we gotta initialize the view group, in other words, the grid view. Okay, so going back, actually no. Okay, so the grid view won't be an ordinary grid view. So I actually was able to retrieve this online, where it's a custom grid view. Okay, so this is, so as you'll see here, it's got swipe functionality, all this good stuff. Here, let me copy and paste this. It'll look better in this IDE. Alright, okay, let's do that. Call it gesture detect grid view. Paste it there. Alright. So what this grid view does, I would say, is considering that it could run swipe functionality on a view group, you know, normally you'd think it'd be easy to like put buttons in it, right? And then just swipe it just like that. But the code towards the bottom of here is able to do just that. So there are two overridden methods here. So first is the onIntercept touch event and the onTouch event, okay? So the problem of this right here is that both of them serve as views of touch events, right? The thing is, like, when you try swiping this after it's rendered, the button view would consume the view group's view. So actually nothing would happen without these two methods here. Okay, so as you'll see here in onIntercept touch event, there's a boolean flag here, my flame confirmed. So what this actually means is that if it returns true, okay, so when it returns true, the view group's view would override the button, which is the child view of the view group. Okay, I know it's hard to like understand at first, but you'll get the hang of it like later on. I should like just study this code. So after this returns true, it'll actually go to here on touch event and return true through the gesture detector class, which is instantiated right here. Okay. So this will be our custom grid view. Okay, so let's here. It should initialize the grid view first. So let's do that. Gesture detect grid view. Initialize that through the initiation method. Should first go to our main activity layout, change this. So what we want is, you know, just a grid, right, to show up in the app, nothing else, because after all, this is a sample project. So let's just do that. We don't need any of this. Okay. So all it is we're rendering is just a grid view. Or our custom grid view in this case. Let's assign it ID of grid so we can actually refer to it. Okay. Now we could initialize it. Okay. Alright, so remember that this grid has three columns, right? So what we could do is set the number of columns to columns, so just three. Okay. So now that that's done, remember that in our display method we want to try rendering all these buttons into a grid, right? So normally we would do it right here after all of the buttons are pending to this array list. But what comes first is building our custom adapter. Okay, so why don't we do that first? Let's call it custom adapter, super class extends the base adapter. Okay, that's good. Alright. Okay, then I'm bringing those methods to actually get this working. Okay, so going back to the display method, we actually want to refer to our array list of buttons, right? So why don't we initialize an array list right here? Okay, so this would be our member variable for the array list of buttons. Oops. Let's go called a constructor. So okay. So that's that. Turn the count. Turn the buttons dot size. Alright. Get item. So let's cast this first. Alright. And then the item ID will just simply be the position. Believe it or not. Oops. Yeah, okay, sorry about that. Alright. So here in the get view when we actually render the views and recycle, this is where most of the recycling happens. Okay. So why don't we do this later? Okay, so okay, alright, going back to our display method, let's actually set our view group, or in other words our grid view, to the adapter. Okay. Custom adapter, and the only parameter is an error list of buttons. So as you'll see here, we initialize it up here, so all we're gonna do is pass it in. Okay. So with this adapter and the grid view, the view group, all of the rendering will happen via here, the custom adapter. Okay. Alright, so we got that out of the way. Okay, so going back here, you know how I mentioned like these tiles here, the buttons, right? How it's like able to fill like majority of, if not all, the screen, right? In pixels. So in order to retrieve the dimensions of each button to get a flexible size like this, we're gonna use what's called a view tree observer to do just that. Alright. Okay, so let's call it set dimensions. Alright. So what we're gonna do here is initialize this. That. This. So as you'll see here, the view tree observer, right? The grid view that right here. So we're gonna refer to the grid view, okay, the size of this as the view tree, alright? So keep that in mind. Okay, so we're gonna add an interface. Okay. And in this method, we'll be getting the dimensions of each of the buttons in the grid. So right here. So apparently the minimum API has to be 16. Okay, let that load. Load sync. Alright, that should have done it. Let's finish building up. Alright. Okay. Alright, so a little formula. Let's see what I think about. So let's refer to the grid view to retrieve. Oh no, sorry, this will be measured with. Oops, cannot spell at all. Alright. One second, guys. Okay, sorry about that. Let's take that phone call. Anyways, so where were we? Okay, we referenced these temporary int variables. So these aren't actually the dimensions we need. We also need the, it's called status bar height. Okay. Got to create my own method there. Let's here it's better here. Let's call it this status bar height. Pass in a context. Alright. So, okay. Let me do everything here first, and I'll explain what exactly is going on in this method. Source ID equals context, get resources, okay, so we need to pass in three strings. Okay. Of course, we'll need the status bar height. So what we're doing here is we're retrieving the identifier, right? The ID of the resources of these three certain keys, okay? And these resources are like scattered somewhere. I don't know. Lord knows like where this project. But if the resource ID exists, and this would be our way of validating that it exists, it's greater than zero, then we'll reinitialize this result int variable. Gets, oops, no, not the color, definitely not the color. And this is where we'll retrieve the actual pixels. Is that passing the ID? Oops. So we'll be returning the results of what's retrieved in dimensions for these three, okay? The three in order to get the pixels that'll be here in the status bar height. So let's actually invoke that. Passing this. Alright. And then another temporary variable for a second value. So we're gonna subtract that from this. Alright. Okay. And now this is what we want here. So this would be the width of one button, okay? Columns. Alright. So we got the width and height here. And this is exactly what we need to get the size for each button inside the grid. So now that we got the dimensions here, right? Normally we would want to, invoke the display because that's where most of the, button rendering happens in the grid view and then ultimately in the adapter, right? So, why don't we pass actually here? Normally I would use this display method, right? To pass in these values as the parameters. But, going back to like what I was saying, right? When you swap each tile, right? It'll need to be, it'll need to invoke the display method here. So if you think about it intuitively, right? Like, we wouldn't pass in the column width and height because these are only retrieved here or set dimensions. So why don't we s so that said, why don't we set these as fields, right? I mean, I'm sure there's a better way, but you know, just for the purpose of the sample. Okay, so let's name it. So those would be our fields. And then let's assign here. Then invoke our display method, right? Okay. So that's that. So going back to onCreate, considering that display is invoked from our set dimensions here, we won't be needing this anymore. Okay. So when this app runs at runtime, after everything's instantiated and scrambled, this will be called, right? So now that we got these, let's actually use them in our adapter. First, we gotta pass in some parameters. Okay, so let's put it here. So let's then let's initialize them as member variables. Let's actually initialize them when it's passed into the constructor. Okay, so after we retrieve these into our adapter, let's actually use them in our get v method. So that's so keep in mind that we'll be referring to each of the buttons in our array list. So why don't we initialize button there, and we'll only retrieve them if the recycle view or convert view is not existent, so if it's null, in other words. So then we retrieve it from our array. Position. Otherwise, we can just cast it into the convert view. So after retrieving our buttons, we then use layout params to actually set the dimensions onto the button. So it'd be like this, layout params. Alright, let's call it params equals new. In our width, which is our member variable that we already assigned in the constructor, and then the height. This look better. Okay, so those will be our params, and then after assigning that, we actually set the layout params with the button. So this is where all the rendering really happens for the button size to get such a good look throughout the screen. Alright. Okay, so now we're gonna go back here into our display method to pass in the fields as the parameters. Alright, so what we have so far is basically a board, a 2D puzzle of each of the pieces of a pigeon, right? So all of them will be scrambled after it's rendered. So why don't we take a look to see what happens on the actual device. It shouldn't take that long. It should work. Oh, okay. Let's see what happens. Don't know why I crashed here. Alright guys, so the bug right here, the Android monitor. So I literally had to like figure this out off screen, but basically it was a very stupid mistake on my part. So going back to the custom adapter. So if you didn't notice anything, like in the get view method, right? So after we have the buttons, right? Treating the respective buttons, and then after like we set the params, the only problem is here, the return statement. Right, so in the get view method, we want to render each of these buttons right to the corresponding view group. But the only problem is that we're returning null instead of what we should be returning, button. So that should do the trick. So let's see what happens then. All right, cool. So as you notice, each of the buttons gets rendered properly, right? So okay, so the grid view here, the attributes width and height is match parent, right? So with each of these attributes, like in regardless of device screen, like it'll be, you know, it'll match the parent, like the whole screen, width and height, right? And then going back to here, the set dimensions method, right? So it retrieve or reference this grid view to set, you know, here, let's go back here, right? So presume that this is matching the whole screen, you know, width and height. In other words, covers the whole screen, right? So it would make each of the buttons, right? And make the fit each of the according sizes, you know? So get like this kind of feel. So each of them are evenly sized. So that's when we get this. But the only problem is, I believe it didn't scramble. Alright, guess we're presented with another bug. Let's see, scramble. Let's test that. Oh my goodness. Okay, so remember how I said we're iterating backwards, right? So in this condition, it clearly wouldn't run because we're iterating backwards. But under this condition right here, when it's less than zero, which is not possible, so hence it didn't run at all. Okay, that should do the trick, I believe. Alright, and now it's scrambled. Okay, so glad that's out of the way. So now that we got the board rendered, now we can just go back to here with the grid view. Okay. So now we could actually test to see what, you know, each of these methods do. Okay. So, as you'll see here in the to-do statements, it says here to implement code when it swipes upwards. Okay. So remember as I mentioned, okay, so in the board here, the buttons consume the touch events from the view group. So without the on intercept touch event and the on touch event method down here, it wouldn't be, the board here wouldn't even be recognized. Okay, so let me show you an example. Okay, so let's just, for testing purposes, let's just display a toast when we swipe upwards. Do that. Okay, and then let's just temporarily comment this out to see what I mean. Alright. Let's rerun this. So, considering that the buttons consume the view group's motion events, nothing will happen. So what I'm doing right now on my mouse is trying to swipe the view group, in other words, the grid view. And clearly nothing happens, right? But say if I refer to these to, you know, react accordingly to when the view group intercepts the button's touch event. Let's see what happens. And there you go. See that I swipe right, test message appears. And down, left, and up. Okay. So this is assuming that I'm dealing with these constants right here for the minimum distance for each swipe, right? And then these other two, right? But clearly, so considering that I'm using a Nexus 5, which is a 5-inch screen, these run flawlessly. But you should like keep an account for like, you know, tablets or small screen devices and change these accordingly. But you know, this is just a sample, so we'll just stick with these in the meantime. Alright, oh, and by the way, so you know how I copy and pasted this code? So if you wanna see this in like a script, I would just go to the GitHub link as provided in my description part. So if you want to find it, just go to or navigate to the app directory, source main, the Java files, and then right here, gesture detect gridview.java, and you can just simply copy and paste this into your project. Okay. Alright. So now that's done. So instead of like just displaying a toast message, why don't we put some functionality for the actual swipes? Okay, so let's just delete this. Okay. So after deleting all of that, what you want to do is we should call it a method to, you know, use the UI from the main activity, because everything's here after all. So in order to do that, we need to create a static method. So we should, let's call it public static tiles. And we should try passing in parameters like, let's see, why don't we pass string for the respective direction, and then the exact position of which tile you're actually touching, you know, before performing that actual swipe. So as you'll see here, the end variable right here references the grid view, right? So it actually points to the position. So it'd be right here for 0, 1, 2, and so on. Okay, so we would pass in this into the method right here. So what we could do then is say for the upper left corner tile, the position would be 0, right? So the functionality for this, so clearly, considering that it's the left upper corner right here, it could only, there's only two options where it could be swiped. And that is, excuse me, that's right or downwards, okay? So let's run the functionality for, say if the direction equals right, then we perform a swap. Here we should also provide. So we should make a method for the swap, because this will be called, you know, tons of times. Let's pass in the position, obviously. And then, okay, so that's for now. Okay. So let's call swap, and then pass in the position. So if we were to go right from the current index of 0, pretty much all you're doing is adding index of 1. Okay, so it'll swipe over here, which is the index of 1, right? So I would say we need to pass in another parameter of 1. Okay, so what that would look like then, let's call this swap. Right. So, as I mentioned earlier, like, if you look at the scramble method, right, you would temporarily assign, you know, temporary variables into memory to eventually swap them and say, like, these lines of code. We're basically doing the same thing here. So why don't we do just that? Alright, let's call this string new, no, definitely not that. String new position equals tilelist. Okay, that should be. So considering that this is a static method, everything within here should be static as well, because it's the context. So why don't we do, okay, let's make this static. This should work now, I believe. Where are you? Okay. Okay, there we go. Then it's pretty much all we're doing is really just adding them, you know. Oops, definitely not that. Don't park over. And that should give us our, oops. Oh, okay, definitely not. And that should give us our new position of an index of 1, since we're swiping, you know, right. Alright. And then, so then the tile, the index we're swapping with, it'll be swapped with the tile that, you know, we're swapping from. So something like that. And then this will then go that. New position, that's right. And then after performing a swap, we should definitely call the display method. So then we could like render the images all over again. So then we should, okay, we should make this static as well. Alright, so that's not gonna work. So then we should pass in a parameter then, context. Should do the trick. What else? Okay, I gotta make these static as well. How fun. Alright, and then finally we pass in. Okay, we should definitely, oh that's right. That, then we should definitely, so considering that our instantiating method here in our custom grid view class has its own context parameter, we should also pass this into the swap tile method. OK. Okay, so what we could do here is add an additional parameter. That'll just be for when you swipe right from the upper left corner tile. Now let's try seeing what would happen if we swipe downwards. Let's call this down. Okay, so if you think about it intuitively, okay, so remember this is an index of 0. If we want to swipe downwards, all we'd be pretty much doing is adding 1, 2, 3. Okay, so that's the number of columns technically. So why don't we context position, and let's pass in columns. Alright. Okay, so that should address that and do everything here under the swap method. Alright, and then otherwise. So considering that could go only right or downwards, we should like inform the user that if they try to swipe up or left from this tile, we should like display an error message. Okay, so otherwise, let's display test saying invalid move. So that's all of that for the upper left corner tile. Alright, now, yes, I know this is going to be a bit tedious, but here let's just do one more before I show you the rest. Alright, so say if you want to do the upper center tile, which is the one right here in the middle, say if it's greater than 0. But less than columns, okay, or minus 1. So we want an index of 1 right here. So why don't we put a condition like 0 and put less than columns minus 1. Okay, this will be the upper center tiles. Alright, so if you think about it, it's not really like, this is not really hard-coded, like the condition, because say if you had like more top, like more, you know, columns, like say if it was 4x4 instead, this condition would also work, you know, and for other columns as well. So if you wanted to make, you know, a bigger jigsaw puzzle, then this is the way to go. Alright. So, let's see, so it's right here, so I can go in any direction besides up, so left, right, and downwards. Okay, alright, let me fill this out really quick and I'll get back to you guys. Alright, so here it is. So, remember we'll be right here, right, the upper center tile. So if you wanted to go swipe to the left, we simply just subtract the index by 1 and pass it into the swap. Okay. For downwards, like I said, so considering it's 3x3, right, which has 3 columns, you just add 3 of the index value to make it go downwards. Alright, so we just pass in that to the swap method. Now if we want to go right, just like how we did with this one, the upper left corner tile, we just add 1 to the index. Okay, so I mean, you get the general idea. Like, as I said earlier, it's very tedious. I mean, it is. But, okay, so honestly, I'll be right back and I'll finish the rest of this and then get back to you guys. Okay, 1 second. Alright, here they are. Beautiful, isn't it? Okay, so one thing I also noticed was, instead of hard coding these strings for each direction, why don't we create, you know, some classes for it, so like we could refer to, you know. So why don't we do something like this? Up would be something like that. Okay. And then that. And then. So for instance, we then change all the up. Let me configure all this and get back to you guys. One second. All right, finish changing all of that after initializing the constants up here. All right, so again, since I'm kind of short on time, like, so obviously I wouldn't have the time to do, you know, cover all this tediousness. But as I said, you can get it from here on GitHub. So navigating to this directory, to my Java files. Just go here to main activity, and then scroll down all the way to right here, move tiles, and then you'll see all of this. You could, you know, just copy paste whatever. All right. So now that that's done, let's go to right the preview class. So we put this as static. So now we could just refer to it. Okay, so move tiles. So it passes in the context as parameter. The direction would be up, as it says here in the to-do statement. So we could just, you know, use the constant here. One second. Oops. I set to public. Do this really quick. Parameter again. Position, that's right. Okay. Let's just do this real quick. Down. Left. For right. And that should do it for, well, the swipe, at least. We're not entirely done yet. But we're almost there. So let's try running this, see what happens. Okay, so say if we wanted to swipe this to down here, and there you go. Each tile swaps for each other accordingly. But say, like, you know, this is like running on a game, right? Like the objective is to solve this jigsaw puzzle, obviously, right? So say if, like, you put each piece in order, like, we should at least, you know, inform the user that the user finished the game, right? That's not the puzzle. Okay, so what we're going to do now is create a method for those stats. So I could create it right here under swap. So each swap you make, right, you check to see if, like, you know, you finished the jigsaw puzzle or not. So we could, let's call it solved. Method is solved, right? And in order to do that, let's initialize the boolean variable over here. And then, considering that each of the swap happens in our tileless string array, right? We're gonna iterate for each time this is called. So, whoops. Let's create a for loop to iterate through each of the values. Okay, so okay, and then what we want to do is so that. So say if, you know, considering that we want to get each tile, each button, right, in order, so that's from 0 to 8 in, you know, ascending order, then we make this solved as like a, you know, kind of like a boolean flag. We keep this true, okay? And then if this is true, here, let me do this real quick. One second. Okay, sorry to run errands really quick. Okay, so as I was saying, so the objective, right, of this method is to make this true, right? Keep this true. So in order to do that, let's make this string dot. Oh, nope. Okay. So through each element inside this tile list, like if this, the index, corresponds to the element, right, in ascending order, then we make the flag true, which is what we want, right? But if it's not, then we keep it false, and then eventually break and exit out of this loop, right? And then return that. Oh, okay, so this should be boolean. Alright. So as long as each of the element inside the list is true, or sorry, if it's equal to the incrementing index value, right, then this will be true and ultimately return true. So that's exactly what we want. So if this is true, then let's just simply, display a toast message. But of course, you can reconfigure it to anything you want. Say something like, "You win." Alright, and that should do it for this whole tutorial. Let's see if that works first, of course. Swipe, 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 swipe. There, there. Okay, let's see if this works. And there you go. See the toast message? You win. Here, one more time. There you go. You win. Alright, guys. So that's gonna be it. So I hope this was really helpful. I mean, probably not the best tutorial out there, considering it's my first time, even like creating a video, but. It's been a while since I've like touched this code, let alone project. So I tried the best I could. It's been like several months since I've looked at this. But if there's any questions, just let me know. My social media accounts are like in the description link. Or just leave a comment. So yeah, that should do it. Alright, take care, guys.